please welcome to the stage Dr. David Awschalom.
It's nice to see some students here tonight. I used to be a student. Really? But like many of you, or maybe like just some of you, I had a lot of trouble in my first semester at college. And it wasn't so much the courses, but the fact that I discovered television. Something my parents really tightly controlled growing up. And in particular, I was captivated by reruns of the original Star Trek series. Led by a courageous and emotional captain, a science officer who was cerebral and driven by logic. And I thought, finally, a role model. You know, in many ways, their world mimicked the world we live in today. Personal communicators, universal translators, holograms, transporters, well, not yet anyway. But at the end of the day, they thrived on uncertainty and discovery to create opportunities for their society, the Federation. And while I had a lot of trouble articulating this at the time, their somewhat rebellious take on uncertainty was incredibly exciting to me. It defied conventional wisdom. You know, our brains are wired as a way to avoid danger. We loathe ambiguity, and we often view it as a threat. But somehow, honestly, I found uncertainty incredibly compelling. It seemed like real possibility. And at the time, I really had no idea how much uncertainty would play a role in my own career of quantum physics at so many different levels. You know, back then, I just appreciated the fact that space would unfold for these Star Trek explorers, that they just didn't know how things would turn out. They just appreciated the fact that that opened up a world of possibility to them, really by not knowing. And that series ended its run in 1969. And that was a year where a chain of events took place that changed the world in so many ways, and in ways we had yet to be able to imagine. It was the year that the Beatles actually held their last concert on the roof of Apple Records in London. The Boeing 747 had its debut flight, the jumbo jet. Woodstock attracted more than 350,000 rock and roll fans to upstate New York, doing, well, what rock and roll fans do. And in July of that year, Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin became the first people to set foot on the surface of the moon in the Apollo 11 mission. It was an amazing time. But towards the end of that year, there was another event that admittedly drew a lot less attention. A group of scientists and engineers got together to demonstrate the results of their ARPA project, a project funded by the Advanced Research Project Agency. And their idea was to link two computers between LA and Palo Alto. And they sat down to demonstrate the system. They typed L, O, and the system crashed. Not their finest moment. But about an hour or so later, they got the thing going again, and they successfully transmitted the first word, login. Yeah, that experiment that began in failure changed the world in ways that nobody could have predicted at that time. Last year, there were over 2,000 billion bytes of information sent over the internet, 5 billion users online with 25 billion connected devices. More devices than people on the planet. And today, in fact, 70% of our planet is covered by some sort of mobile network. It's amazing that that discovery at the time changed the world in so many ways that we couldn't perceive. Even by people who worked in the field. Take the laser. When the laser was first proposed, leading scientists at the time, including, honestly, several Nobel laureates, said it was impossible. They said it was impractically difficult. Interestingly enough, when that first scientific paper proposing the laser was submitted, it was rejected by the leading scientific journal of the time. And for years afterwards, it was talked about as a solution desperately looking for a problem. But do you think that those inventors of the time could have possibly imagined how ubiquitous the laser is with us today? From LASIK eye surgery, to supermarket barcode scanners? Really? You know, even to new tools that help us discover the universe. The point is, uncertainty and discovery lead to incredible opportunities. And you know, those explorers in the Star Trek world knew that as they explored outer space. And today, we know that more than ever when we explore inner space. And by inner space, I mean the world of individual atoms, electrons, photons, single particles of light. And in that world, nature behaves in ways we don't experience in every day, a world in which we have virtually no intuition. but it's again providing extraordinary opportunities. Because in the world of inner space, at that length scale of single atoms and electrons that we call the quantum scale, things are very, very different. In our world, sort of the binary world of information, information is present or absent. It's zero or one. In the quantum world, information is an infinite combination of zero and one, a so-called superposition. And the value of that information depends exactly on how and when you look at it. It's the way the quantum world works. But in a way, you can think about it this going from a world of black and white into color. There's so much potential here, this type of dynamic. And there's one other thing. The way you connect these different types of quantum bits of information is quite special. They can be entangled with one another. A type of quantum Facebook, if you like. Yeah, where the act of looking at one bit impacts them all. And here's the twist. This happens even without a physical connection. We're in an extraordinary moment right now in the world of science and technology, because for the first time, we're able to create, control, and engineer this quantum behavior, bring it to our scale, the human scale, to create fundamentally new technologies. And much like the laser and the internet, this is likely to impact us in ways we can't possibly imagine today. It's a very, very special moment. But we're starting. About 15 minutes south of here at the University of Chicago, scientists and engineers are working together to create incredibly interesting and highly speculative new types of information processing system based on quantum technology. Individual atoms are placed using focused lasers into big arrays, building prototype quantum computers that, in many cases, are able to solve certain types of problems faster than any future extrapolation of any supercomputer. Semiconductors, the materials we all use today in our cell phones and our laptops, and actually for this presentation, people are building atomic memories, single atom memories, where a single atom can store a billion bits of information. And just to put that in a scale, in a piece of material smaller than the grain of sand, you can store more information than atoms in the observable universe. Completely redefining, what do you even think about information and memory? And very recently, quantum bits have been made out of individual proteins, able to go inside living cells as sensors, aiming to do early disease detection. Imagine hospitals being able to improve magnetic resonance imaging 20 orders of magnitude above what we can do today. These things are very, very possible, and they're happening very quickly. And what's more, here in Illinois and in the Midwest, we've installed hundreds of miles of optical fiber to create entangled quantum networks, to begin to connect quantum sensors, quantum computers, quantum communication links, entangling this information in very special ways. Things are moving really, really quickly right now. It's an incredibly exciting field. But for a lot of us, it's a little bit like we're driving 100 miles an hour in the fog, for some of us more than others. We're trying to stay on the road, and the road is being built in front of us as we're driving. It's an extraordinary time. But it's pretty reasonable to ask, how might some of us actually meet this quantum technology? When will we see it? How will it impact our lives? I wanted to give you a really brief example of this. I'm guessing a bunch of you have been through O'Hare. I couldn't tell if that was happy or sad, but okay. I'm going with happy. So it's likely that you arrived on a plane, and you might ask, how do you build an airplane? A Boeing 787 has 2.5 million parts. And imagine if a company knew, on day one, how to build this airplane perfectly in order. You would revolutionize manufacturing. And quantum optimization algorithms are able to attack problems exactly like this. Now, I'm also going to limb, and I'm going to say that I'm guessing some of you were waiting at a gate for your plane. And you might think, how hard is that to get a plane to a gate? Well, harder than you might think, because even in, a small rural airport, say in Iowa, where you might have 10 gates and 5 planes, it's hard to appreciate, but there are 100,000 ways to assign those planes to the gates. Do the math. If you think about O'Hare, okay, with thousands of planes and hundreds of gates, these are problems, again, that quantum optimization algorithms can help resolve. On a more serious note, you probably purchased your airline ticket with a credit card. And last year, there was over $12 billion in consumer fraud, and over a quarter of a billion credit cards compromised. Quantum encryption is incredibly promising as a way to secure our information and make it hack-proof. And finally, you want to reach your destination safely. And this year alone, there have been over 1,500 spoofing attacks on GPS for pilot navigation, trying to confuse pilots, trying to determine their destinations and flight paths. Onboard quantum sensing is likely to help alleviate these issues. The point is, from transportation to healthcare to business, quantum technologies are likely to impact all of us. The real question is, can we do it? This is a once-in-a-generation moment for Chicago to become global leaders in this rapidly emerging area of quantum science and engineering. Can we do this? I think we can. Chicago, after all, is a city that reversed the flow of rivers. It built the first skyscraper. It is the city of big shoulders. But make no mistake, this is going to be very hard. We have to come up with new ways of working together, new ways to develop education, be prepared for applications with very little notice, and to surmount problems that we can't foresee. But the fact is, we've already begun. A few years ago, the United States passed the National Quantum Initiative Act, authorizing 10 national centers to launch collaborations to move this science into technology and the marketplace. And after a massive competition across the country, 4 of the 10 national centers have been placed here in Illinois, which is a measure of how well this region collaborates. And the state has been an extraordinary partner, putting hundreds of millions of dollars into building new labs here in Chicago to translate discovery to society, and to launch the Illinois Quantum and Microelectronics Park, the largest state effort in the country to build quantum manufacturing. And interestingly enough, it's at the old US Steel site. Amazing, from steel to quantum. You know, thinking big to think very small. Not surprisingly, we're not alone. If you stand back, this is a global competition. This color-coded map gives you a sense of countries around the world that have launched national quantum programs. And for those of you with very good eyes, like really good eyes, you might notice that Illinois' investment is comparable to several countries. We're a player in this game, and it's a remarkable moment. And while we have great universities for research, and we have great national labs in Illinois, Illinois has one other significant advantage in the country. We have one of the largest community college systems in the nation. And you might ask, why is that important? Because the next decade, it's expected there'll be over 800,000 jobs created to build the most critical aspect of this, a legion of quantum engineers. Where will we get quantum engineers? We have to train them. 200,000 of those people are projected to be here in the Midwest. And why is the community college system so important? It's important because 70% of these quantum jobs are for people with associate degrees, high school degrees, and undergraduate degrees. And as one company executive said to me not so long ago, you know, David, the last thing we need is more people like you. Again, really? Not the nicest person. But he makes a point. This is incredibly important for us. And if we stand back and we look at the history of other once-in-a-generation changes in technology, global collaboration is incredibly important. You know, Mark Twain famously wrote, "History doesn't repeat itself, but it often rhymes." And working globally, we need to attract the best and brightest people here into Chicago, into the Midwest. We need to nurture them, help them develop companies, bring new ideas. This is important not just for Chicago and the Midwest, it's important for us to maintain global leadership in this area and set global standards for quantum technology. You know, when I think back about my freshman years in college, at least some of my freshman year in college, I realized that, you know, in many ways, our world is so much more connected than the world of those Star Trek explorers. In ways that even science fiction, areas like teleportation, are now a reality. Now, while we're not able to teleport people or large objects, we are able to teleport atomic information over 100 miles without physical connections, creating a goal of global quantum entanglement to share information around the planet. It's a remarkable time on the precipice of this new technology. Here we are at such an exciting time in history. We're ready as a city to work together with so many questions, but the one thing I know for sure is here in Chicago, working together, we can boldly go where no one has gone before. Thank you.